Hey everyone, welcome to TexConnect, a learning center for textiles. Today, we will be starting with a very important topic and also a very interesting topic in synthetic fiber production. The topic for today is melt spinning. As the name suggests, in melt spinning, the polymer is melted to the required viscosity and then this molten polymer is pushed through a shower-like nozzle known as a spinneret. And here the filaments are extruded from this spinneret. And once these filaments are extruded, they are drawn to the required orientation and then cool down so that they can get solidified. And then they are wound onto the chase or the cone. So in melt spinning, only thermoplastics can be spun. Thermoplastics are those which when heated will change the physical state without changing the chemical state. So polyesters, polyolefins and polyamides are all thermoplastics. For example, if polyester polymer chips are melted, it will reach a glass transition temperature. A glass transition temperature is a temperature at which the material undergoes a change from being glass-like to being rubber-like. So from being solid like a glass, it will come down to being rubbery kind or vice versa. So once this polyester polymer chips reach to the glass transition temperature and after that they will melt. And again on cooling down, these polymer chips will solidify. So in this entire process, there was no chemical change that was involved. It was just a physical change from being solid polymer chips to molten polymer and then again solidified fibers. So now let us have a look at the passage and the machine parts of this melt spinning machine. So let us begin. So on this slide, you all can see a diagram of the melt spinning machine and all the parts that are listed out. So we'll be learning each part in detail and also let us have a look at the passage of the machine. So the first part is the polymer feed hopper. The name itself explains the function of this part. So here in the diagram, you can see on the top, there is a polymer feed hopper. The polymer chips are fed into this part, which then feeds this polymer chips to the screw extruder located right below it. The next part is the screw extruder. Now in this zone, the polymer chips are melted to the required viscosity. And then the screw pushes the polymer further into the spin pack. The next part is metering pump. So this metering pump basically helps in maintaining a uniform output of the molten polymer by forcing only the required amount of polymer further. So the required amount that is required for the spinning process and to maintain a uniform denier, only that much amount of polymer is metered ahead. The next is filter pack. So as the name suggests, it will do the function of filtering. So this part filters out all the impurities, also bubbles and all the gaseous bubbles that are there, and homogenizes the melt so that there is no hindrance to the extrusion and uniform denier filaments can be spun. The next part is the heart of this process, the spinneret. So this is a shower-like nozzle that has many holes drilled onto it. The polymer melt is pushed through these holes and as a result, we get the circular cross-section long filaments. Now next part is the quenching chamber. So here, fluids and mostly air is used to cool down the filament so that they solidify, and also some amount of drawing due to air takes place in this quenching zone. Next is the spin finish applicator, which applies the spin finish, that is a lubricant, onto the filament. So this improves the anti-static properties, lubricates the yarn and also provides cohesion. Next is godets. So these godets are very important in getting the required orientation of the filaments. Here the main drawing, or rather the filaments are pulled before winding onto the spool or the final take up takes place. And finally, the take up process, where the filaments are taken up onto the spool or also wound onto the cone or a cheese. It depends on the end product or the end package that is used. Now, let us study each part in detail so that the entire melt spinning process is clear. Barrel and screw arrangement. So, as we saw in the introduction part, the polymer chips are fed into the hopper. And now, from the hopper, it is passed to the barrel and screw extruder. Here, there is a cylindrical barrel in which there may be one or more rotating screws that are closely fit. So here in the diagram, this is a single screw extruder. So y'all can see only one screw that is there inside the barrel, which is closely fit. And this barrel is heated along its length. So this heating can be done either by oil or it can be electrically heated. Then the polymer is partly melted by this heat and also partly melted due to the frictional heat that is generated due to the mechanical shearing of polymer by the screw. So both the frictional heat and also the heat that is generated from the oil or electrically, due to this combination of both the heat, the polymer is melted. And now let us see how the material will move inside this barrel and screw arrangement. So there are two possibilities that may take place. First is that the material will stick to the screw and on rotation, it will slip onto the barrel surface. But with this, there will be no output as the material will rotate with the screw and the material won't get pushed further. So it will just keep rotating with the screw. And the second possibility is that the material sticks to the barrel walls and slips onto the screw. So the rotational speed of polymer here is less than the rotational speed of the screw. And due to this, the material is pushed further by the leading edge of the flight. So here in the diagram, you all can see the leading edge of the flight, which is there. And that will push the material further towards the spinneret, towards the spin pack. So now moving on, next, let us have a look at the screw extruder. The one shown in the diagram is a single screw extruder. Now this single screw extruder is divided into four zones, or rather any screw which is there, it is divided into four zones. These four zones, let us see each one in detail. So the first one is the feeding zone. So the feeding zone is the zone where the solid chips, the solid polymer chips are fed from the hopper. So the second zone is the melting zone. This zone extends over a considerable length up to a point where the last crystallite in the polymer has melted. So here in this zone, the entire solid polymer chips which were there, they get converted into a molten polymer and also a required viscosity is achieved. The third zone is the metering zone. Here, the pressure builds up and the melt is homogenized. The pressure buildup is due to the combined effect of the unrestricted flow of the material, that is the drag flow, and the opposing pressure due to the constriction at the extruder exit, that is known as the backflow. So the volumetric flow is governed by this combined effect, that is the drag flow and the backflow. And the overall output is reduced. In the metering zone, the melt is not thoroughly and completely homogenized. So next is the mixing zone. Here, the melt is completely homogenized. And also, as we can see in the diagram, a close clearance mixing zone is incorporated to promote intensive mixing. And next, through the channels of cylindrical pipes, this molten polymer is now passed onto the next part, that is the metering pump. So the metering pump, the main objective of this metering pump is to make sure that at all given times there is uniform supply or output of the molten polymer to the spin pack. So here in the diagram we can see two intermeshed gears. They are the main part of the metering pump. So the output and input are perpendicular to the intermeshed gears. So for example, if the input is at the top, the output is perpendicularly downwards. And the quantity of melt passing through the metering pump can be given by the number of teeth of the gears that are getting filled and emptied in a unit time. So this metering pump regulates the output or the throughput of the polymer from the spinneret. This throughput rate and the winding up rate together decide the denier of the spun filament. So now moving on to the next part, that is the filter pack. Here usually fine graded sand or alumina is held in place by metal screens or sintered metal discs. So as shown in the photo besides, there is a set of filters containing 3 to 5 filter meshes is used, where the top one is a coarser one. So the coarser ones are used first, followed by the finer ones. These filters allow small particles of titanium dioxide, TiO2, that is added sometimes to the fibers as a delustering agent. Now, what if the polymer is not filtered? So there may be foreign matter that may pass, and also it may clog the spinneret holes. And this clogging will lead to reduced throughput, and eventually a lower denier filament will be spun. So there will be imperfections in the spun filament. It will not be uniform, and also if the denier is less, it may form weak places and eventually the yarn will break or the filament will break. And also due to filtration, there will not be any bubbles that will be passing ahead or any gaseous particles that will be passing ahead. And so there will be no hindrance to the extrusion process. And once the polymer is filtered, the distributor ensures a proper supply of this polymer melt to the spinneret holes. Now moving on to the next part. This is the heart of the whole melt spinning process, or we can say the most important part of the spin pack, the spinneret. So this is a shower like nozzle that has holes through which the polymer is pushed and filaments are extruded. So here in the diagram you all can see how a spinneret looks. And also there is a machine, there is a photo from the machine where the filaments are getting extruded. So a spinneret is about a 3 to 30 mm thick metal disc with holes of around 100 to 500 micrometers drilled into them. And these holes may be arranged in a number of patterns. For example, they may be in concentric circle pattern, they may be parallel pattern, like they may be parallel to each other, or they may be scattered. So it may be in any pattern, and there may be a number of holes depending upon the type of monofilament or multifilament that has to be produced. So the cross section of the filament also depends upon the cross section of the holes. So there may be different kinds of cross sections, such as circular, trilobal or hollow. So if there's a hollow cross section, it will produce a hollow yarn. Now moving on to the next part. This is the cooling system, and this cooling system is also known as the quenching system. Here a mild flow of cool air at a lower temperature of around 15 to 30 degrees Celsius with low to moderate relative humidity is passed through the quenching zone. So due to which the filaments that are in molten state get solidified. So in simple words, the polymer which has been spun into filaments was in molten form and is at a higher temperature. So now to get it solidified, we need to cool it down. So this cooling is done with a stream of air. So with the solidification of the filaments, also the filaments are drawn with the help of this air. So here the uniformity of air is very important, because if there is a variation in the air, there may be variation in the drawing, and also that may cause a variation in the yarn diameter, causing unevenness. So let us now see the configuration of the quenching chamber. So this configuration can be of three types. First is the cross flow. So the diagram at the top is that of the cross flow. Here the cool air flows from one side of the spinneret to the other side. So it is used when a limited number of filaments are to be spun. The advantage of this type of configuration is that the construction and maintenance is very easy, and no special type of spinneret design is required. And many of the industry mostly use this type of spinneret because the maintenance is very less, and also no special type of spinneret design is required. And the disadvantage is that since the airflow is from one side to the other side, the filaments on the side from where the air is flowing may dry quickly and more compared to the filaments on the opposite side. So the second configuration is outflow. So here the cooling air enters from the center of the spinneret and flows outward radially. So here a quench air chamber may be required in the center of spinneret. So a particular design may be required where there is an air chamber in the center of the spinneret. Again, the maintenance of this will be difficult. And the third is the inflow. Here the cooling air flows from the periphery of the spinneret inwards, radially inwards towards the center of the spinneret. And here also a chimney may be required in the center of the spinneret. So again also here also there may be a special kind of spinneret design that may be required, that may have a chimney in the center of the spinneret. Now both the radial flow configurations are used for spinning of 10,000 holes or more. So when the number of filaments to be spun are more, only that time these radial flow configurations are used, as there is uniform cooling of filaments in radial out and radial inflow as compared to the cross flow. But however, as we saw, the construction and maintenance is difficult in both the radial flow, and also special spinneret designs are required. So next, after quenching, the filament passes through a device called as the spin finish applicator. Here a spin finish, that is a lubricant, is applied to the filament, and as shown in the diagram, it is applied by a kiss roll technique or a spray technique. So what is this spin finish and what are the functions? Spin finish is basically a lubricant, and there are many problems when we spin thermoplastic fibers. So it reduces those problems. So let us see what are the functions of this spin finish. First is it provides lubrication to reduce the friction between the filaments and between the filaments and the metal or the ceramic parts. The second function is that it provides anti-static properties. So as we know, thermoplastic fibers have an inherent property to generate static charge. So here, to allow the dissipation of anti-static charge generated due to the contact of yarn with machine parts, this spin finish is used so that it can provide us anti-static properties when the yarn comes in contact with the machine parts. And the third function is that it provides cohesion to keep the filament bundles together so that the unwinding process becomes easier. Now moving on, the next part is the take-up winder. But before the filaments are wound onto the winders, they pass through a set of rollers. These rollers are known as godet rollers. So these godet rollers are very important in maintaining the orientation of the filament. So the filaments are drawn when they pass through these godet rollers. And as the result of this drawing, the orientation of polymer chips in the filament increases, and hence strength is imparted. So here the drawing operation and the the drawing operation is done and also the strength is imparted. So that is why these godet rollers are very important. And the next is these filaments are then wound by the take-up winders onto the cone, cheese or the spool. So there are two types of drive to the winder or to the bobbin. First is the friction drive. So here the bobbin is driven by the friction and the surface speed remains constant. But as the filament comes in contact with the friction roller, there may be abrasion resulting in poor yarn quality, and hence this friction driven drive is nowadays not used. So the next is straight winders. Here the bobbin is directly driven by a motor. So speed is also constantly regulated to maintain a constant tension, and the quality of the yarn is also maintained in this straight winders. So this was all about the machine. Now let us have a look at some details. In conventional melt spinning process, two steps, spinning and winding, were carried out separately. So the filaments were spun and wound without being drawn, which is known as the undrawn yarn, and in the next step the filaments were drawn. So this is known as a drawn yarn. So in the two steps, first the undrawn yarn was produced and then this undrawn yarn was taken and drawn and a drawn yarn was produced. So spinning was done at a speed of around 600 to 1500 meters per minute, and the spun yarn was then drawn at a ratio of 3 to 4.5. So then there was a improvement in the process. Then came the direct spin draw process. So in this process, both the spinning and drawing steps were integrated together in one continuous operation. So here the spinning speed is about 4000 meters per minute and the winding speed is about 6000 meters per minute. And in this operation, the spinning and the winding take place simultaneously, and the drawing is also done in one machine itself. Now next is the high speed spinning process. So spinning at high speeds to produce partially oriented yarn. So this POY, this is known as partially oriented yarn. This means that the yarns are only partially drawn and partially crystallized, and they can be drawn at a later time. So as we saw that the godet rollers were drawing the yarns at the end. So in this partially oriented yarn, the godet rollers or the filaments are not drawn fully. They are just partially drawn and partially crystallized, so that they can be drawn at a later time. And such partially oriented yarns are extensively used for texturizing process. So the spinning speeds in this high speed spinning process are at around 3000 to 4000 meters per minute. And next is super high speed spinning process, where the spinning speeds are around 4000 to 6000 meters per minute. So here also a fully oriented yarn is produced. So this was it from my side, guys. This was all from melt spinning. And if you all have gained any knowledge from this video, please like this video, share it with all the textile people you know. And for more such textile related content, please follow and subscribe to TexConnect, a learning center for textiles.